My name is Raoul Barbet. I'm the creative director and music supervisor of Life is Strange, and here is Sébastien Gaillard, the audio director. We are here today to talk about the use of music in Life is Strange, in all the Life is Strange games we have created, Life is Strange 1, Life is Strange 2, and the awesome adventures of Captain Spirit. How we have integrated the music between the creation of the score and the use of licensed tracks. First, we are quickly going to present ourselves and our background.
Hi everyone, I'm Sébastien Gaillard, a video game audio director. I've started my career as a sound engineer in music recording studios, mainly for Sony Music, but also worked on Femi Cuti's album Shoki Shoki, a famous Afrobeat artist, as an engineer assistant. My first video game experience began at Cryo Interactive in 2000, mostly on adventure games. When the studio collapsed, I became a freelance sound designer for Ubisoft, Darkworks, and Arkane Studio, where I work on the amazing Dark Messiah of Mighty Magic game. In 2010, I've joined Dontnod on Remember Me, and I'm now audio director on Life is Strange games, working closely with Raoul.
So my name is Raoul Barbet, I'm a video game and film director. I've studied engineering and I've begun my career in the cultural and audiovisual fields, in film festival, for example, in Canada and Europe, and audiovisual center in Cambodia. The first game I've worked on was Heavy Rain, on both motion capture and game design. I've moved to the film industry with Illumination MacGuff and The Lorax, as a layout artist with the team behind Despicable Me. After this film, I missed a bit of interactivity, so I joined Dontnod for the first game of the studio called Remember Me. And then Life is Strange, sorry, that has begun as an indie project to become an important brand for Square Enix. The game was a huge surprise, and we decided very quickly to continue to work with Michel Corr, the other director with me, and Jean-Luc Cano, the original writer. Between the two Life is Strange games, I've co-founded an animation studio based in Paris, Capsule, specialized in high-quality CGI trailers and cinematics. But let's go back to the game now and all the work we have done with Sébastien.
So today we will talk about the use of music in the three games we have created. Life is Strange 1, 5 episodes during 2015 and early 16. We follow the character of Max Caulfield. The awesome adventure of Captain Spirit in June 2018. This game is completely free, so don't hesitate to play it. And you will discover the character of the young Chris. And finally, Life is Strange 2. Episode 1 and 2 are already out, episode 3 soon, following the two brothers, Sean and Daniel Diaz. We won't talk about the game Before the Storm that has been made by another development team. As you see, we switch our graphic engine between the first and the second Life is Strange, as well as updated our Wise version. For the ones who don't know about the games, here's a video showing the mood of each one.
Fortress, have you spotted Snowmancer?
Not yet. Keep me posted.
Chris, breakfast.
Okay, Dad.
You
You're drinking beer?
I don't need a lecture from my son.
I always get picked last for the team at school, and they never throw the ball to me.
They can't tell stories like you can they?
No way.
I have no idea where we are.
Feels like we're walking nowhere.
I don't think Daniel understands what's going on.
There's nothing we can't do, as long as we're together.
So here is the plan we are going to follow today. First, a general introduction to our project and the way we use music. The first scene we have created, and how it gives a general philosophy behind the games. We'll talk about the creation of the score and the use of licensed tracks, the interaction between our characters and the music. We'll conclude with a piece of word about the artists themselves. We wanted to warn you that this talk contains some spoilers from Life is Strange 1, only, I think. Sorry for that. So for the ones who don't know about the franchise, I will describe very quickly the games we are creating. It's narrative-driven games where player choices and consequences are very important. It can be seen as an evolution of the old adventure games with mostly exploration, interaction, and dialogue choices. They take place nowadays in the same realistic universe. You can have links between them. We tell stories of believable characters facing real-life issues and exploring different sides of our society. We also want to deal with difficult themes. For the first Life is Strange, for example, difficulties you can face as a teenager, to become an adult, social harassment, depression, and or grief and education for the second Life is Strange. We try to put the player in interesting situations where choices can be difficult and impactful. Let's go back to the music. Music was a huge part of the project since the beginning. Why? Because we strongly believe in the power of sound and music in narrative and wanted to use them as a key element. But this use has to be original and linked to our story and our characters. It has to bring a lot to the scenes. To achieve that, we decided very early in the production to have a mix of licensed tracks and original score. Our stories take place in a realistic world, so the presence of existing songs was a great way to anchor them into reality. And of course, also to emphasize the emotion of some sequences. I work with Sebastian for years now, and I was really happy to begin a project where we will be able to work hand in hand. So we are discussing a lot with the audio team, and also Michel Kor, the other director with me, about the songs and all the score. A lot of questions are always asked before beginning to work on a scene. What is the purpose of this scene? Why having music at this specific moment? Why this artist or this original score? It's really important to have a good reason to have a song or music in a scene. We didn't want to create a jukebox of songs we like just because we want to hear them in the games. It's really important and it's sometimes difficult to choose them for this reason. So it's a lot of research, listening to artists, taking some notes about each song to be prepared to find the good one. Also, as music supervisor, I have to be careful that each song is really meaningful, but also could be used in a sequence or on a cinematographic point of view, for the rhythm or the length, for example, and will work on a technical point of view. I will let Seb talk about the technique.
So the audio integration is not very complicated on a technical point of view. Tips and methods that we will show you are already used in a lot of games, The idea here is more on how we use those techniques with the constraints and the style of game we are creating. Due to episodic formats, games format, sorry, we have to finish all audio, music integration and mix before launching a new episode every 3 months. Every main features may have also to be finalized in the first episode for technical reasons. License tracks have also to be secured early. Money and overall budget are of course part of the equation when selecting a track and find a good balance with the original score. So our main engine middlewares used on these games were Epic Unreal Engine 3 and 4, Stenberg Nuendo, Audio Kinetic Wise, Cryware SoftDeck 2 and RadTools Bink. So you will see all along this talk many contents based on them.
We think the first scene we have created in Life is Strange Games is a good example to begin with. This scene was used to sell the project to Square Enix. It's a moment in the first episode when Max, the main character of Life is Strange 1, is reunited with an old friend, Chloe. Here it is. In this scene, she is discovering Chloe's room after 5 years. The player can really dive into Chloe's universe, and it was really important to describe this character perfectly as the player will follow her during 5 episodes. A lot of details can help in this kind of moment: writing, acting, body and voice, design, interactions, environment, camera work, and of course music. Here we have the chance to include Santa Monica Dream by Angus and Julia Stone. This song was important because more than just describing the mood of our characters, it gives this nostalgic feeling to the whole scene and shows what will be the indie folk vibe we have tried to keep all along the episode.
So this first scene is quite simple. The way it has been done is usual in movies, but it was something we wanted to try and see how it can render in our game. Like Raoul was saying, the whole audio direction really started here by engraving the music in the heart of the game. So the player as Max has to find a CD. The music will be played in 3D from the speakers. So as you can see here, you can see the evolution of the sound. We added pan, filtering, and of course reverberation.
Anyway, you can find tools to fix your camera in the garage.
Chloe, are you okay?
Sure, I'm awesome. I just want to blaze and be alone for a moment.
So we wanted this music to begin as diegetic, or part of the world, and then become extra diegetic, or traditional score, when the player takes control of Max.
I haven't seen this place in 5 years. Seems like forever.
By doing this, the song is treated like in-game musical score, accompanying Max as she discovers Chloe's house.
I feel autumn pushing out the summer.
This is creating a bubble around Max and the player.
Following this idea, let's have a look at another example from Life is Strange 2. At the very beginning of the game, we have the song Listomania from French band Phoenix. During this scene, Sean Diaz, a 16-year-old teenager, is coming back from school with his friends. We wanted to have this teenage movie feeling, a light and festive atmosphere, to contrast with the terrible event that will occur after. On the music treatment, you will see that it's the exact contrary as the previous example. Here, a song in 2D is used as score and will be transformed into diegetic coming from the bus. Again, very classic cinematographic technique. Notice that the video and song has been cut just for this presentation.
Mistomania. Think let my tears grow.
Another example from Life is Strange 1 is the use of Breton's music with the title Got Well Soon. The main character, Max, is seeking for a murderer in the middle of a pool party. The song is not chosen by the character. Here, it's an element of the world around her. The EV sound is quite impressive, and the idea was to reinforce the oppression Max can feel by being there, and the difference between her and the people around.
So, as Raoul said, we wanted this song to be massive in terms of audio rendering as soon as the player opens the curtain of the entrance. Let's see. So you hear the song in 2D at the beginning, but we also added a 3D layer of this one that came from the speakers as the player is back in gameplay on the dance floor. Also, the core gameplay feature of Life is Strange 1 was the rewind. Anytime the player used it, we managed to go back in time in the track. Just to explain quickly some technical aspects, this is a global view of the swimming pool level in Unreal Engine. We used a wise blend container with three synchronized tracks, 5.1 for global rendering for players who got the chance to play in surround, a monofile for the speakers. The green 3D sound you see here are not playing audio, but they send the RTPC based on the player distance from speakers to the track. And at last, another stereo muffled version of the song when the player is in the bathroom at the back of the party. The whole track is a mix of 7 songs that last around 13 minutes, made by Louis Martin, the sound designer who worked on this scene. Additional tracks in this remix have been selected from a global music company we work with called Audio Network. I'm sorry. As our technology did not handle full audio rewind, we used a faked Unreal Matinee, which embedded the Wise Blend container. It allowed us to resynchronize the music whenever the player decided to rewind. We also manage checkpoints and restore the exact time in the audio track by seeking in the matinee when reloading the scene. Raoul, let's gonna talk about the original score now.
Jonathan Morali, you can see him here, has composed the original score of Life is Strange 1 and 2. Jonathan is the leader of the French band Scene Matters. They have released 4 albums since 2003. I'm a huge fan of Jonathan since the beginning, And when we have started to think about Max's character and the mood of the game, the music of Sid Matters came quickly in my mind. The feeling you have listening to his music is exactly what we wanted to achieve with our game. This nostalgia, sadness with moments of hope and incredible melodies. We have used very soon two titles of the band in the first episode. Jonathan has already composed for movies, animated features and documentaries, but it was his first game. He's a gamer, so he understood very quickly our needs. We wanted to thank him today for his incredible work.
So for Life is Strange 1, Jonathan delivered around 30 minutes of music covering 8 different themes, dedicated to characters, Max and Chloe, Kate, or to area of the game, campus, Blackwell Academy, and to different moods of the game, Golden Hour, Alternate Realities, The Storm. Jonathan had to compose something that was enough structured as a whole song and could be used in various ways. Each theme should be representative of the song if played alone. Every song can be looked forever without being boring or losing the feeling of the game. In the end, we made more than 4-hour music remix based on these 13 minutes. For Life is Strange 2, the story was a road trip. We knew that we wouldn't be able to reuse the same themes, so we aimed for much more than the first one to cover all of our needs in terms of moods, characters, and to be able to have an evolution of the music all along the episodes.
To show how we work on the score, we will take the example of what we have called Zen sequences. In our games, at specific occasions, the player can choose to take his time, sit on a bench like on the screenshot, lie on his bed, and it will launch a Zen sequence. It's a peaceful moment allowing to dive into characters' state of mind, Max, Chris, or Sean, and learn more about their feelings. The player will hear voiceover, but also enjoy new camera angle and music. Those moments of contemplation and nostalgia are optional and are a reward for the curious players who take their time. For each of them, we have edited a unique remix of Jonathan's score based on the situation, the writing, and also the mood of the scene. The example we are going to show you is coming from the fourth episode of Life is Strange 1. Max is in a parallel timeline because of her action, and the character of Chloe is now suffering from an important handicap. The bedroom we knew is no longer used. The player will find an empty one full of memories. Max can sit, and we will launch a Zen sequence, allowing the player also to think about the past actions. You see the Nuendo session here, and we will add new layers to the music, acoustic guitars linked to Max during this sequence. Notice that we have only kept the music in the extract without voices and sound effects.
So this is how the transition has been managed in WISE for most of the Zen sequences. To achieve a better in-out of the three guitars in this example, we use the same time playing segment WISE feature, rather than doing this with a multi-track and a classical RTPC linked to the volume. This allows the guitar to come at the grid, which is musically better than at random points. We also added a fade-in out between those two segments. Guitar will come quickly as the player triggers the Zen sequences, but will fade a longer time on exit.
Another example of the use of the score is the menu. As our games are episodic, the menu is really important for us because it's a way to bring the player back in the universe of the game. As you can see, on the Life is Strange 1 menu, the background view and the ambient sound are evolving, but the music is staying the same. The strong main theme of the game linked all those different menus together. For the second opus, we wanted to begin with something very similar to Life is Strange 1, with a folk vibe and this neighborhood feeling. So at the beginning of the first episode, you will have this menu. After the terrible incident in Seattle, we wanted to break everything the player and the two brothers knew before. They have left Seattle and are now alone on the road. So during the same first episode, if the player is going back to the menu after the incident, the menu will have changed, and also the music. So it's another theme. The Seattle theme you've just heard is no longer playing, and is replaced by the one from Into the Woods. The player will be able to listen to the Seattle theme only during the moments when Sean is thinking about the past and his father.
So another important thing we wanted to have an audio link and consistency between the score and some major sound players' feedbacks. Major choice is a moment when the time is freezed to take an important decision. We use an extract from the first composed score. It's not a sound effix, but an edit of three different stems mixed together that can loop forever until player makes his decision.
Whose is it?
I'm sorry, that was my joint.
Well, well.
So no matter what music is playing at this moment, it can blend and highlight this suspended time. The consequences of player's choice is shown by an animated butterfly. We also use some very small elements of the score for this feedback. At last, we almost did the same with the inventory sound. We used a simple guitar chord taken from some additional recording session with Jonathan.
So the music of our game is a mix between original score and existing licensed tracks. So we now are going to analyze some songs we have used in our games. The first example coming from Life is Strange 1 is a scene where you hear the last words of one opponent of Max, Nathan Prescott, who has already disappeared. The rhythm of the voice of Nathan, the beat, the silence, the reaction of Max are very important in this scene. In the meantime, Max is in the middle of a huge tornado and the whole city is beginning to be destroyed. So I will show you a video of the scene. Listen carefully to the music and we will discuss about it just after.
I told you.
I trust Limbo have been warning you people for years that our culture of sin and entitlement would lead to God striking us down. And I'm the one trapped in this fucking radio station. Somebody get me the hell out of here now! Now, goddammit, or I pay all those taxes!
You have one new message. Message received yesterday at 9 p.m.
Max, it's Nathan. I just wanted to say, I'm sorry. I didn't want to hurt Kate or Rachel or I didn't want to hurt anybody. Everybody used me. Mr. Jefferson is coming for me now. All this shit will be over soon. Watch out, Max. He wants to hurt you next. Sorry.
So we can think here it's a specific score composed for this sequence, but we used an existing track. The name of the song is The Sense of Me by Mudflow, and the track is not edited at all. Let's explain quickly how we proceed when we work on a sequence like that. The first step is to feel the important moments of the scene. So here, for example, we have the escape from the dark room with a car and the introduction of the end of the world feeling, the radio speech that gives more pressure, the reception signal of the message, the message itself, and Nathan's excuse. Nathan saying, I'm sorry, which is very emotional when you know the guy. Max's reaction to the fact that those are his last words, and of course the destruction of the town, the moment Max exits the car and the player is back in gameplay. Here is a Nuendo session we have created to show you the process. You can recognize the different voices in pink, green, and yellow. You have the song itself in blue, and we have schematized the different layers that are composing the song. It's not the real layers because we don't have access to them, but it's to show the principle. Again, the only change we have made on the song is the volume. So the second step will be to analyze the song and the important moments that make us love it. We will then try to maximize the synergies between the song beats and the sequence itself. For example, the beginning of the melodic guitar while escaping the dark room, the drums and bass to break the radio speech and prepare for the reception of the message, the violin entrance and what I have called the takeoff that gives to Nathan's message a lot of emotion, the first vocals just after Nathan has warned Max and begin to apologize. Just a quick note about lyrics and vocals in a song. It's really complicated to mix them with a character talking. We have to be careful to keep them understandable and emotive. It's sometimes less than a second that changes a lot for the feeling you want to create. For example, I remember spending a lot of time with Sébastien to find the right moment to have the sorry moment of Nathan and the entrance of the backing vocals. It's a classic technique, but when it works, it could completely change the feeling of a cue. You have noticed the electric guitar at the very end to highlight the tone destruction and the moment when Max is exiting the car, keeping only the melodic guitar with all the other layers down, with, in the end, the huge ambience of the storm coming up. So it's a lot of back and forth between the audio team and the camera team to finalize this kind of scene, with adjustments in editing and framing. So I wanted to thank the camera team for their patience and incredible work. It could be seen as small details sometimes, but I think it helps to have the emotion maximized. I know a lot of players love Nathan. I think he's one of the most interesting characters, lonely and sad, so it was important for us to take some time for his ending sequence. That is even more true that he was only there through a voicemail.
So you can see here how this scene was built inside the engine to achieve seamless transition between gameplay, real-time, and pre-rendered cinematics. It was really important for us to maintain a continuous flow on the screen. So we used the Bing video in between the two Unreal levels to avoid any loading screen. This ensures us a perfect audio synchronization no matter the hardware platform. Because on Life is Strange 1, the challenge was also to make this work on all generation consoles, PS3 and Xbox 360, as well as next generation. This kind of process Raoul has described was used many times when we have some music behind. He analyzes the track to create his cinematography on top of it. Here are some other examples we have used this process and seamless transition in Life is Strange 1. The discovery of Rachel, the ending of episode 3, the endings of episode 1 and 5.
Here we have worked with the songs as a whole, but sometimes we are very lucky and we can have access to tracks separated in layers. So we will take the example of the Awesome Adventures of Captain Spirit. The process is a bit different in this case because we are able to use a track in a new way, not just having an existing song on top of images. We can reduce the volume of one instrument, create a new mix, cut or create loop for a choice, for example. It's incredible for us to have access to this level of interactivity on an existing song. Of course, what is really important in this case is to keep the spirit of the song, its strength, and to preserve the will of the artist. As we can do all the changes we want, we have to be careful to respect the original work of the musician. So we'll take the example of the song Death with Dignity from Sufjan Stevens, which has become the score of the Awesome Adventures of Captain Spirit. Sufjan is one of the greatest folk artists of our time. We are really proud to have it in this game and wanted to thank him again for his trust. So in Captain Spirit, you play Chris Eriksen, a lonely and imaginative child who has lost his mother and lives alone with his father. The player will have to discover during this game the past and the difficulties of this family. This song and the whole album Carry on Lowell is very personal, talking about Sufjan Stevens' mother's death, dealing with difficult themes. So it was of course resonating with our own story.
So we have decided to split the song in three parts, corresponding to the three verses of the original. The first one is played when you see the introduction of the game. You discover Chris' universe, the neighborhood, his bedroom. It creates a perfect mood for our story.
Spirit of my silence, I can hear you, but I'm afraid to be near you, and I don't know where to begin.
The second part of the song is played if the player is going to the treehouse of Chris and launch a Zen sequence. It's an interesting moment because Chris is lonely in his world and is able to think of his mother.
table. Is it real or a fable? Well, I suppose a friend.
One of the missions of Chris is to find an hidden treasure. It's a small box with memories of his mother, drawings, photos. Susan Stevens is talking directly about his mother only in the third verse of the song. It was supposed to be a moving moment for Chris and the player.
I forgive you, mother, I can hear you, and I long to be near you, but every road leads to an end. Yes, every road leads to an end. Your apparition passes through me in the willows and five red hens. You'll never see us again.
So this song is perfect for us to create a beautiful and unique soundtrack for the game, give a new insight on Chris' background with another very personal and strong family story, and reward the players that are curious and manage to dive into Chris' universe. We have used again some moments of this song when Sean and Daniel are meeting Chris in the second episode of Life is Strange 2.
We didn't want to use our songs just as soundtrack, but also make them real part of the world, something that the characters can interact with. The next example is one of those interactions, to thank again the players that are curious and want to dive into character universe. You will hear a song from Jose Gonzalez, Crosses, an artist that Max likes a lot.
Home sweet home, my favorite cocoon.
So Max enters the bedroom and can launch some music on a stereo. So you hear the sound in 3D, like if you were in your own bedroom. While listening, you can do different interactions, read a book, water a plant. But you can also grab your guitar and sit on a sofa. So you'll hear Max playing. This layer have been composed by Jonathan Morali on his own guitar, and we have asked him to play as a teenager, a bit late, with some mistakes. If you are still playing when the song is finished, Max will continue to play alone. And of course, if you decide to get up, the last track will stop. So this kind of small interactivity with the music, very simple, give a lot to the universe, because of the realism of the situation, and to the characters, because of the mood of Max and the way she's playing guitar.
For the first scene of the main character of Life is Strange 2, Sean Diaz, we wanted something different. He's younger than Max, lives with his father and young brother. So we wanted the right mood and atmosphere while listening to his first song. We decided to have a song from the streets on a flip of a coin. The player enters Sean's room, discovers his universe. It's quite similar as the scene you've just seen with Max from Life is Strange 1. Sean can listen to music while doing his stuff.
Time to get in the mood for tonight.
I really like that one.
I don't totally suck.
His little hand grasped in anguish as he weighed up his coin.
Somewhere blue-eyed, a girl in the world, she's waiting for a boy.
Footprints trailed as if trod by slaves.
So you can hear the character singing or trying to sing on top of the song. Again, we have asked our actor Gonzalo Martin to sing during the voice recording. He was quite stressed about that, but it gives this great feeling you have when alone in your bedroom or in your car, you sing very badly. You all know this moment, I think.
So to achieve proper synchronization between the song lyrics and Sean voices, we use the Wise Music Custom Cue system by setting every moment we wanted Sean to sing. We also asked our audio programmer to implement callbacks from his custom cues in Halloween blueprints, allowing us to get them in real time and trigger the relevant voices from Sean. I just wanted to show you the overall blueprint that was handled by Yannick Tassin, the sound designer responsible of this scene. We had to manage checkpoints, 2D, 3D versions of the song, as well as ensure that our system went through the global voice manager of the game. Another quick example of our characters interacting with a song is at the end of the first episode. Sean and Daniel are safe in a motel room, and the player has something terrible to announce to his little brother. When you are going back to the room to do so, Daniel has launched the TV and just want to dance on the bed. We use Block Party's song Banquet.
Okay, don't think about it. Just tell Daniel the truth. Are you kidding me?
Remember that song?
So in this specific case, as the player can take all the time he wants to make his choice, it pushed us to create an infinite loop in the song. So we have split the track in three segments, intro, loop, and end. So the song feeling is preserved. On top of that, we use also a 3D, 2D effect when both Sean and Daniel are dancing together. And the music will of course stop if Sean gets out of the bed and switch off the TV.
So we are very lucky to use music from a lot of great artists. We wanted to thank all of them again today. We thank a lot of people today. But it's a very long process to have all those artists involved, and here is a quick description when everything works. As already explained, for the selection of tracks of the game, we gather titles from a lot of artists. For each track, I keep as much information as possible, the meanings of the lyrics, the feeling listening to it, the beats of the song, but also the backstory of the artist and the track itself. It ends in a huge file full of song titles. As soon as I select a title, we will test it with the audio team and also the camera team, if it's a sequence. If we are happy, we can ask for price and finalize approval and contract. It's long and complicated to get artist and publisher answer. We work with Feel for Music Agency in London, and thank you again, Ben and Glenn, maybe they are here today, for their help about all those contracts. Video games, media, can be still seen as a car chase or gunfight only. So we have to explain a lot what we are doing and the type of game we are creating. I write letters for the artist, show some images, explain our philosophy. But it's changing very quickly nowadays, so it's really cool for all the artists. Again, this process you've just seen here occurs when everything works perfectly. In reality, it can also be like, we don't have enough time to listen to all the music we would. Nobody agrees with you, never. Each time you test on a sequence, it doesn't work, but in your mind, it was just perfect. You check the price and it's too expensive. And let's say now that everything is working great, every camera shot fits perfectly the song, you manage to deal the price, and in the end, the artists say no. So, of course, it's not always like that with those steps in this specific order. Every case is really different, but it's for sure a very long process dealing with financial, legal, and creative aspects. First of all, you can see the names of the different artists behind the artworks we have seen during this presentation. We wanted to thank them for the wonderful work they have done. As a conclusion, working on the music and how we integrate it in our games is one of the things I prefer in Life is Strange projects. It's something very long and difficult, but it's like alchemy, and when it works, it's really, really powerful. Let's end with some advice. You can, of course, follow them or not. Every project is, and every team is really different.
So, first of all, the most important for us is don't use too much music. Even if we love it, the main danger for us is to put too much music in our game. We have to be really careful with that. We really believe that it always be better to have some at very important moments. We have seen too many games that have destroyed the strength of a musical score by putting it everywhere. For the little ones, do not create a jukebox. Do not select a song only because you love it. It's really important to always communicate with the other teams. Even if the music is great by itself, it could not work if the scenes and the design are not prepared for it. Third one, don't ask too many people for feedback and choose the songs wisely. Music is very personal and survey can generate a lot of frustration in a team. Be sure you have a general coherence in your music. Having only one people is the best way to achieve that. It could be the main composer or the creative director, like for us. And last one, always have a plan B, even a C. Easy one, but you have so many unexpected events and you really have to be prepared. Thank you, everyone, for listening.
Thank you for your presence. Thank you.